Welcome everyone to this webinar hosted by Toradex. Today I'm going to share some thoughts with you about how to do power management in a simple and versatile way with the Verdin system modules. My name is Gustavo Leal and I am a field application engineer at Toradex. Before diving into the webinar, let me cover a few organizational points. Please use the chat window of the webinar tool if you have any technical issues and wish to let us know. In the end, we will also do an interactive Q&A session. You can type your questions in the chat window at any time and we'll pick them up at the end. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing soon. With this, let's get started. I'll begin with a very brief overview of who Toradex is and what we do. Toradex is focusing on making embedded computing easy to use so you can get simple access to latest technology for your product development. We're doing so by providing highly reliable ARM system modules, SOMs, including software and support. We strive to offer the lowest cost of ownership to you, and this doesn't just mean the module price, but we're also considering aspects like your development effort, time to market, and long-term maintenance. We're proud of being able to provide industry-leading support, including a very active community and a developer page with over 800 articles and daily updates. As you can see on the map, we're based in Switzerland and have offices all around the world, offering local support, sales, and warehouses. Here is a short overview of our products. We have three SOM families. Inside these families, the modules are pin compatible, so you can seamlessly scale from the low-cost IMX6 ULL to a power-efficient IMX7, right up to the new IMX8s. The Colibri family is industry proven for more than 15 years, offering industrial interfaces, versatility, and power on a compact form factor. The Apollos family offers even higher performance and high-speed interfaces such as SATA and PCI Express. Our all-new module family is Verdin, which is introduced with the IMX8 and Mini and Plus SoCs. The Verdin modules offer high-speed, modern interfaces in a compact, future-proof form factor. I'd also like to explain our focus applications as we are optimizing our products and offerings for them. We are in industrial automation, healthcare, including medical devices, transportations. We are on cars, trains, and drones, for instance. Test and measurement, such as calibration equipment, and smart city applications, such as IoT gateways. Typical projects are from customers with volume requirements of a few hundred to a few 10,000s of products per year. Toradex itself has thousands of active customers. So let's get started with the main subject for the day. Also, be sure to check our other webinars on the Verdin SOM family to get to know more about this new form factor if you haven't already. This is a lightning webinar, so I'll just scratch the surface of the documentation we have and present the power management features while analyzing some common use cases. Everything I'll talk about today is based on the Verdin carrier board design guide. I'll offer links and more about our hardware design resources later. So let me begin by highlighting the main power requirements of the module. For the first time, we're offering modules with this wide input voltage range from 3.135 volts to 5.5 volts. This makes it possible to directly use single cell lithium ion batteries to power these modules. Also, the Verdin modules have built-in control signals that can be used to manage the power behavior of other peripherals on your carrier board. We designed Verdin for a max TDP of 5 watts, but allowing for higher peaks. So we recommend designing for a TDP of 10 watts or more. Most GPIOs run on a 1.8 volt logic level. Most newer SoCs tend to run GPIOs on that voltage, and we're seeing more peripherals that operate on that voltage, but you can always properly level shift if you need. To make things easier, the Verdin sums output a 1.8 volt, 250 milliamp reference voltage, which you can use to power peripherals on your carrier board without necessarily including a separate buck converter. Before I get into analyzing some use cases, let me quickly present some terminology used for the power control signals. They look like the name of the function dash the direction of that control, which can be either an output from the module to the carrier board peripherals. This is MOCI for module out, carrier board in, or an input to the module from the carrier board peripherals, MICO for module in, carrier board out. Also, a hash at the end of the signal name means the signal polarity is reversed. I mostly refer to this as active low. These are some of the signal names extracted directly from the design guide. For example, the first one, control reset MOCI hash, is an output from the module to reset carrier board peripherals and comes directly from the SoC reset signal. Hash at the end means this is an active low signal, so a low-level signal means to reset, and a high-level signal means normal operation. Check out the last one, which is control reset MICO hash. It is an input to the module. This means it resets the module when asserted, or shorted to ground as it's active low. I'll explain all the signals as we encounter them in the use case analysis. Let's go to the first of the couple use cases we're going to go over today. I'll highlight the main points while analyzing the block diagram top to bottom. So this might be the simplest use case for a Verdin carrier board. You can power this directly from 5-volt USB, making sure you use the correct circuitry. But actually, this can be any power supply matching the wide input voltage range of 3.135 volts to 5.5 volts. These examples uses no battery nor the internal module RTC, so we leave this VCC backup signal disconnected. Here, we are using the module's own 1.8 volt output to supply the peripherals on the carrier board. So let me just highlight this for you. This one. We're using this 1.8 volt output to supply the peripherals on the carrier board here. This already saves you some money and PCB real estate since you don't need to add a buck converter to generate a separate 1.8 volt supply. That would be necessary here if you didn't have this signal here. You're just going to need this buck converter if your peripherals use more current than the 250 milliamp that the module can provide. Optionally, you can add here its control power button MICO hash. This simple push button will short the signal to ground. This signal offers two behaviors. A short press turns the module on if it's off, or sends a shutdown command to your operating system if it's already on. That's similar to the power button behavior we're used to from PCs. In the same way, a long press forces a shutdown if the module is already on. The only control signal going to the peripherals in this example is a control reset MOCI hash. Is this one here. This is the SoC reset output. Since it's active low, you can see it's pulled up to VCC here for normal operation. It will go to a low logic level when the module is reset. Connecting this to a reset pin on a peripheral, for instance, will make it reset when the module is reset. Then we have another optional push button. This one, that when this is pressed and shorted to ground, the module will reset immediately, independent of the software. So this is a manual reset. The next case features both a power supply, which can also come from USB, but can be any supply, and a battery. Thus, a carrier board like this will work either plugged into the power supply or use the battery when it's not. Here, we are assuming common values of 3.1 through 5 volts to 4.4 volts for a lithium-ion battery, which is within the input range of the Verdin modules. There's also a 5-volt boost converter, which will generate 5 volts for any peripherals that might need it. Here, you can see we're using the control power enable MOCI signal to enable this 5-volt supply. The signal, this power enable signal, goes high just after the module is powered, which guarantees that the peripherals will be supplied early. Just like in the previous example, we are also using the 1.8 volt output from the module to power any peripherals that might operate on that voltage. So it's this one. We are also introducing finer peripheral power control with the control sleep MOCI hash signal, which is an output from the module to be connected to the sleep pins of peripherals. The signal is asserted and goes low when your operating system goes to sleep, thus also putting peripherals in their respective sleep states. This is particularly important for saving power on a battery-powered product. Likewise, there's the control wake one MICO hash signal, which is an input to the module. If you want your system to wake from sleep based on an interrupt coming from a carrier board peripheral, that's what you should use. Again, this is pulled up to VCC, and any peripheral that drives this to ground will wake your OS from sleep. As in the previous example, the control reset MOCI hash signal is connected and will reset carrier board peripherals when the module resets. Here, we are adding an optional recovery mode button, this one. Holding this push button when powering on your board will make it boot into recovery mode. This is mostly used in development when you either soft brick your module, something gets corrupted, or you simply want to flash another image. So that's why it's optional. Be sure to check the recovery mode article on our developer website for more info on this. The last signal, again, is a simple push button to manually reset the module. We always want to make sure you get your product out in the field as fast and safe as possible. That's why we offer many resources to make your hardware development smoother. Make sure to check our page on carrier board design. Here's a screenshot of that page. All our carrier board designs are free and open source, and they can be downloaded in Altium format. You can even check the schematics and layouts directly on the website with the built-in Altium viewer. Also, check the Verdin carrier board design guide, which is the document on which this presentation is based. Actually, power management is only a chapter of the guide. It is chapter 3, by the way. The guide also covers all interfaces and consideration on pins, signals, and schematics. Mechanical and thermal aspects are also covered there. We also have specific carrier board design guides for our other module families, Calibri and Apollis. On the layout side of things, we also have a layout design guide describing best practices when laying out your carrier board PCB, such as recommendations on high-speed signals, impedances for high-speed traces, considerations about layer stackups, and much more. I find this a very interesting read, not just for carrier board layouts, but for PCB layout in general. So make sure to check this out. Make sure to always check the datasheet for the module you're working with. I've linked the datasheet from the Verdin IMX8M Mini and also a preliminary datasheet for the upcoming Verdin IMX8M Plus. So with this, let's get on to the Q&A session. Okay. First question is, where can I find more information about building a custom carrier board? So we have presented a two-part series of webinars about building your custom carrier board. Feel free to check this out. You can, it's on the carrier board design page on our website. We also have an extensive proven partner network, including third-party companies offering hardware services so they can design or manufacture your carrier board. Another question, how do the modules deal with power cuts and sudden resets? This is interesting and important. The modules themselves are tolerant to power cuts and sudden resets. All you need to do is to make sure you keep your input voltage within range. So that's the 3.135 to 5.5 volt range I talked about. Also, on the software side of things, the file system formats we used on Linux, that is ext4 and modules with emmc flash, they are resistant to corruption, but there are sure some best practices to make sure you never lose any important data. And well, I think that's all I had for today. This is just a quick overview of what we have. Don't forget to check our developer website with lots of documentation, our community where you can ask your questions and interact both with other customers and Toradex engineers, and our labs page where we host some of the new projects we're researching. Thanks so much for watching, and goodbye.